We're fortunate tonight in that the organizations represented here in this panel are more than ready to put you to work, to do good work, to make a difference for the lives of our community and for the lives of our neighbors. And so we're very excited to hear what they have to say tonight. Moderating our discussion is going to be David Brown. David's a friend, a resident of the 47th Ward, very active with the Common Pantry, who they are proud to say Chicago's longest serving and best pantry in all the city, if I may say so in my unbiased opinion, and has a host of experience in these issues. So without further ado, I'll let David get us started.
Thanks. Thanks, Jason. I think my most important job tonight is to just keep things moving along as fast as we can, because as Jason pointed out, one of the great things about these community forums is that we really want to get on to what goes on after it. So I've been to a number of community meetings, and I must say it's such a pleasure to see neighbors get together for something positive, for something they believe in, for something they want to learn about, and that they care about. So this doesn't seem to be a torch-carrying, pitchfork-carrying crowd. So thank you all for being here. And as Jason pointed out, I'm on the board of Common Pantry, which many of you probably do know. We're located at the basement of Epiphany United Church of Christ, which Pastor Kevin McLemore is the pastor at Epiphany. We also have our executive director, Kathy Trainer, and our board president, Ann Zender, here tonight. Common Pantry, in addition to being the longest serving food pantry in the city, we serve about 1,200 of our neighbors in need every month with emergency food. And through the great support of the community, we've been able to look at the problem of food insecurity and go beyond that and do learn more of what some of these groups here do in terms of really what some of the root causes of food insecurity, so we can more in a better way refer our clients and work with these organizations to help them with some of the root causes, much of which has to do with affordable housing and health care and employment, which you'll hear about today as well. So what I thought, and then also Kathy and Ann will be in the back with the other organizations to talk about Common Pantry. We also have free copies of our book called I Am Your Neighbor. And just a note about that, that was something that came out of some of those other meetings where people came to complain. And what we thought at Common Pantry, the best way to counter that was, after continually taking the high road and trying to really implement changes at Common Pantry, we said the best way that we could probably counteract some of the opposition was really to understand that a lot of that came through either misperception or misinformation. So we allowed our clients to speak for themselves. Roger Wright is here in the back. Roger led the charge with us to put together a book called I Am Your Neighbor, which is really just an opportunity for a lot of our clients to tell their own stories and really share the struggles in their lives and what brought them to the door of Common Pantry, so we can all better understand them and hopefully work with these organizations to help them better. So thanks everyone for doing what you're doing. I thought, again, what I would do tonight would be introduce each of our panelists here, tell you a little bit about the organization's work all at once, and then because we do have one mic, we'll ask them each to come up and give their 5-minute presentation on the organization, and then we'll open up to a Q&A, and as Jason said, then we'll go to mingling in the room, meet them one-on-one, find out in the back what you can do with certain organizations to really get involved, learn more, and have a direct impact in your community. Okay, so we're going to start off, and I may mispronounce some names, but I'll do my best. We'll start off with Heartland Alliance for Human Needs and Human Rights. Many of you are familiar with Heartland Alliance. Tonight we're privileged to have Natalie Brzozowski here. She is the program manager of Independent Supportive Housing and Health Initiatives. She oversees that program, which targets working individuals who are chronically homeless and we think are some of the most vulnerable in the city of Chicago. Her program provides case management to formerly homeless residents in four Heartland Alliance subsidized apartment buildings, and then also social services that are designed to assist residents in reaching housing stability. They do that through personal growth and well-being. Services consist of case management, employment, career development, financial literacy, substance abuse counseling, and other housing services. Natalie has been with Heartland Alliance since 2011, working with a number of their permanent supportive housing programs. This includes collaboration with the AIDS Foundation in Chicago, four additional programs funded through HUD, and housing opportunities for people living with AIDS. She will be able to talk about some of the supportive housing programs that Heartland Alliance does. We also have Ted Peso, who's here with the Knight Ministry. Again, I'm sure many of you are somewhat familiar with the Knight Ministry and the bus that you see around various parts of the city. They work to provide housing, healthcare, and human connection to members of our community struggling with poverty or homelessness. They accept people as they are, and they work to address their immediate physical, emotional, and social needs while affirming their sense of humanity. As I mentioned, they have the health outreach bus, youth outreach van, and the youth shelter network. And each year, Knight Ministry provides social services to approximately 5,200 adults, teens, pregnant, and new moms who have nowhere else to go. Ted has been with the Knight Ministry since 2008. His primary role is to build relationships with elected officials and policymakers in the government through the work that they do to connect with them. He regularly attends Knight Ministry at various CAPS and neighborhood association meetings, so maybe we can hear how the best way to engage with community groups when there is some opposition or questions on how we can best be involved and address, you know, what might be problems through through the various neighborhood organizations. We also have representatives. We have both Jason Gehrig and Carlos Navarro from the Northside Housing and Supportive Services. They help men and women end their homelessness through housing and comprehensive supportive services. They're on track to help more than 800 people this year through interim housing, permanent supportive housing, a day support services center, health services, and other programs. Jason has his master's in social work from the University of Kansas. He's previously worked for Inspiration Corporation and has employment and volunteer experience with the Center for Economic Progress, Christian Peacemaker Teams, and Jewish Vocational Service in Kansas City. He completed a policy internship at the National Coalition for the Homeless in Washington, D.C. And next to Jason is Carlos Navarro, in addition to being our AV guy to get the mic working here. Carlos just asked that I introduce him simply as a community leader. So I would love to hear exactly what Carlos is able to do in that capacity. One Northside, at the end we have representatives. We have both Robert Rodenberg and Mary Tarullo. One Northside is a mixed income, multi-ethnic, intergenerational organization that unites our diverse communities. They build collective power through innovative community organizing and accomplish this through developing grassroots leaders and acting together to affect change. So I imagine that something like tonight is a big part of what you guys do. Mary is the director of organizing at One Northside. She's been organizing since around 2005 around many housing issues, including securing affordable housing at the Children's Memorial Hospital, new development in Lincoln Park, preserving over 100 units of at-risk homes at the Presbyterian Home Senior Affordable Housing, and also working on the city's SRO, or Single Room Occupancy Preservation Ordinance. Robert is a member of One Northside, and he's been involved for the last since 2013, when he was living at one of the Chateau Hotel, which was shut down and converted to market rate housing. So since then, Robert has been a leader on numerous campaigns, including the successful SRO preservation ordinance as well. And he currently lives at Lakeview at Buffett Place, which is owned by Brinshore and Thresholds, two other organizations that are very active in our community. So I'm going to turn it over to each of them to tell you a little bit more detail about what they do, why they do it. And when we think about homelessness in our community, I think that, you know, being aware that it is an issue in our neighborhood, I think we all get a chance to see it in many different ways and understand that it is a serious issue. But I think we can also feel very fortunate in this neighborhood to have people and organizations like this that can help us combat, learn more about it, learn more about the people who are suffering from homelessness and what we can all do. So we'll start with Natalie. And we only have one mic tonight, so we'll be running back and forth.
Thank you so much for having me today. Obviously, it sounds like a lot of people in the room probably have heard of Heartland Alliance, and we're a very large organization that have a great portfolio of services. And so obviously I'm here tonight to talk specifically about housing, but I definitely encourage everyone in the room to check out our website and see kind of the other areas that we work in. Heartland Alliance, we consider ourselves a human rights organization, and so that's really the lens in which we provide the services. And so we have kind of four arms. We have our international programs where we provide services and human rights in various countries throughout the globe. We have a healthcare arm. We do have an arm called Heartland Housing, which is a little bit different than the arm that I'm presenting from today, in which literally Heartland is a property owner, and they work in the city of Chicago to provide affordable housing through housing management. And then Heartland Human Care Services. And Heartland Human Care Services is really looking to provide basic needs for folks who are vulnerable. We do this by safeguarding their human rights, providing opportunities for positive change. And so I'm just gonna quickly kind of run through some of the housing programs that we have through Heartland Human Care Services. We have the program that I directly oversee, which is our permanent supportive housing programs. And so as David mentioned, we are working with folks who are formerly homeless, they have a disability, and we're placing them in scattered site units throughout the city of Chicago and providing a subsidy. And then they're getting intensive case management to work on whatever barriers they may have to really maintaining that housing stability. Because our folks are often coming to us with chronic medical conditions and disabilities, health is also a really big component of the work that we're doing. So we're really trying to engage them in healthcare and really improve their overall quality of life. And the program that I work with, again, is permanent. And so as long as the individual needs those services, the services are available to them. We do have also rapid rehousing programs, which are 8 to 24 months of subsidized housing for the household. They're, again, connected to case management and getting intensive case management services to help kind of build their self-efficacy so that at the end of those 8 to 24 months, they're really able to kind of move on and maintain their housing independently. We also have a supportive services for veterans families program, which really targets veteran families. That program can be 9 months of rental assistance to help them really get to a place where they can maintain their housing independently. And then the program also offers one-time assistance for those folks who might be housed but at risk of homelessness, and that maybe that one-time assistance can kind of get them back stabilized. And then, as I mentioned earlier, with Heartland Housing having properties throughout the city of Chicago for affordable units, Heartland Human Care Services places case managers in those buildings to provide those intensive case management services to the folks who are residing in those buildings to kind of offer that same support so that they can really maintain their housing in those programs. And then in terms of youth, we also have a very similar model to our rapid rehousing program, 24-month program for folks who are 18 to 24 and experiencing homelessness, and they're getting intensive case management again to kind of build whatever self-efficacy to get to a place where they can move on and be able to maintain their housing. And then in addition to that, we also have homeless prevention funds, which are open kind of to the public. We get referrals from the Chicago 311 line, where we're interacting with folks who might be, again, at risk of homelessness and really need some one-time assistance to get back on their feet and be able to maintain their housing moving forward. And then in addition to kind of all of those housing programs, we also have some auxiliary services to really help support that the work that we're doing around housing. So that includes mental health outpatient services that we can provide the folks that we're serving in addition to the case management services we're providing. And then we also have HIV prevention programs that are working with our folks because we recognize that a lot of our folks may be engaging in activities that put them at high risk of contracting HIV. And so that kind of also brings me to some of the models that we use. So for all of our programs, we are really approaching the work from a housing first model. And so we recognize that the folks that are coming to us are oftentimes coming with a lot of barriers. And so we try to minimize any barriers to getting them into housing. So for example, we're not looking for folks to engage in mental health services. They don't have to be sober. They may be, you know, not ready to really engage in services. When they're referred to us, we're looking to get them into housing and working on those barriers once they're kind of stable. Because we recognize that it's hard for folks to really focus on some of their issues when they're living on the streets and they don't really have stability in their lives. Also, when working with folks that might be engaged in high-risk behavior, one of the other models that Heartland really adheres to is a term that we call harm reduction. And so a lot of times people are familiar with that term around substance abuse, but we really broaden that perspective in the work that we're doing, that we know that folks are engaged in a lot of risky activity, whether it's sexual practices, whether it's substance abuse practices, whether it's just poor tenancy practices. And so the model that our case managers really work with our participants is kind of recognizing that change can be slow and change can be hard. And so I'm really working to identify what are those high risk behaviors and how can we kind of work with them to minimize the risk of their behavior until they're really ready to move towards positive change. So that kind of really sums up some of the work that we're doing. Some of the quick initiatives that I just wanted to talk about a little bit when it comes to permanent supportive housing or housing in general in the city of Chicago is that a lot of our programs are federally funded. And so one of the big things that is underway in terms of federally funded housing in the city of Chicago is that the Housing and Urban Development Department has required that continuums of care, which Chicago is its own continuum of care, must develop a coordinated access system. And so you might be wondering, like, how do people get into our programs? And this kind of answers your question, is that as a system, we have been tasked with developing a coordinated way to get people into our programs by assessing their need and targeting the highest risk, most vulnerable individuals in our system. And so right now we're utilizing something called the centralized referral system, which is kind of an assessment that ranks people based on vulnerability. And then as units kind of open up in these housing programs, we are mandated and obviously want to target the folks who are most vulnerable. And so we're in the midst as a system of kind of perfecting that and developing assessments that can really, number one, target the most vulnerable, but also make sure that folks who need the permanent supportive housing are placed in permanent supportive housing, and those who might just need the 8 to 24 months are placed in those programs. And so we can really maximize on the resources that we have because we know that they're minimal. And then that being said, since we know that resources are scarce, and I think we'll talk a little bit more about funding with some of our other panelists, is that Heartland is really part of an initiative to really try to maximize on unique funding through other stakeholders. And so we recognize through research and through the outcomes that we've had through our programs that housing is really one of the number one determinants of health. And so that really impacts health providers, and it also really impacts insurance providers. And so with the Affordable Care Act, a lot of our folks that we serve have been able to be covered through the expansion of Medicaid. And so what we've really been targeting is insurance providers who recognize that through permanent supportive housing, we are able to really reduce the medical costs of individuals in our programs versus when they're on the streets or they're using emergency rooms as kind of an escape from cold winter nights. And so we're really trying to maximize their collaboration to help support some of the services that we're providing by really working with them on some of what we call their high frequent users and saying, if we can get money to put them in housing, we guarantee that their medical costs will go down. And so that's really something that we're trying to be at the forefront of and really seeing if some of our services can be Medicaid billable and that we can really demonstrate that housing is a healthcare, you know, is part of healthcare and it is a health service. And so that's another really big initiative that Heartland is spearheading and part of pilot projects around that we're really excited about. So great, thank you so much. Sure.
Can you please explain what case management is or what you were talking about referred to case management?
Sure, thank you for the clarity. Really case management, what we're working on with folks is really a participant-driven kind of goal setting system. So when we work with folks, we're really working with them on what are some barriers to them maintaining their housing and also what are their just personal goals. And so most often, again, it's around housing, it's around housing stability, healthcare, if they need to be linked to benefits. And then we really have what we call this kind of service plan or goal plan to really drive the services that we're providing. So where does this individual see themselves? What are their goals and how can we support them in getting there? And so that can look like referrals, that can look like skill building, that can look like just helping them navigate systems that they're not used to navigating. So it really can look different based on the individual and where they are. And that's kind of another term that we use, you know, meeting somebody where they're at. So some folks may come in and what they need in terms of case management may look very different than somebody else, but it's usually driven around a goal plan that's developed in collaboration with their case manager. Great, thank you.
Hey everyone, thanks for having me. Can everyone hear me? Okay. So I was asked to talk about homeless youth. The Knight Ministry has been around for 40 years, and one of the areas that we specialize in is serving youth and young adults who are experiencing homelessness. So when we say youth and young adults, that means anybody who is age 18, or as young as 14, up to age 18, and then on to 24. So it's kind of grown to be, to incorporate a larger age range than it used to. What is the size of this issue in Chicago? We really don't know. We don't have a great assessment tool to see how many young people in Chicago are experiencing homelessness. The numbers we usually use are from the city of Chicago, CPS, Chicago Public Schools. And we know last year there were about 18,000 young people who were identified in Chicago Public Schools as homeless. And that definition is a really wide definition. So it incorporates young people who are what we call couch surfing. So that means if I was sleeping on my aunt's couch, I didn't have a legal right to stay there, but that's just where I'm staying. Or my family was staying with an extended family member or a neighbor, then I would be considered homeless in Chicago Public Schools and then be eligible for a number of different services provided by federal law. Of that 18,000, about 2,400 of them are what we call unaccompanied. So that means young people who are experiencing homelessness on their own without the support of family members or their guardians. We know that number is low because that's just Chicago Public Schools numbers, and that's just young people that have been identified. So that number is probably, in all actuality, much higher. So why are young people homeless? The number one reason that we here at the Knight Ministry is due to family dispute. And that could be around a lot of different reasons, right? The number one reason that we see is young people who identify as gay, lesbian, bisexual, or transgender. When they come out, a lot of times that causes family conflict and they end up on the streets or they end up bouncing around from family member to family member, and then they run out of family members, right? So then they end up on the streets and coming to us. We serve them in a variety of ways. When we meet young people, oftentimes they've experienced violence on the street. So over just about 60% of young people in a recent survey in Chicago reported that they experienced some type of violence while they were living on the streets. We also know that young people on the streets have a really high level of depressive symptoms, about 70% of young people. But we also know they're really resilient. So over half of the young people we work with have high school diplomas or GEDs. And a very high number have high self-esteem. So there's resilience there to work with. And I think that's one of the great things about working with young people is they are so resilient and they do have so much hope about their future. We serve them in a variety of ways. So we have a street outreach program. You may have seen our van out on the street at Belmont and Halstead. We're out there Thursday nights. That program's been around for a really long time and provides street-based services to young people who are either experiencing homelessness, who have experienced homelessness, or who are at risk of experiencing homelessness. We provide them with food, case management services, just a connection to a listening ear, hygiene supplies, things like that. Anything that they need to survive and have their needs met at that moment, we're able to provide them right there on the street. We also have an overnight shelter called The Crib. It's located near Addison and Halstead in the basement of Lakeview Lutheran Church, and that program's for 18 to 24-year-olds. We have 21 beds there, and young people come in at 9 p.m. and leave at 9 a.m. It was really designed for young people who, for whatever reason, weren't able to access other youth programs or didn't feel like they were ready to access some of the more structured youth programs. So the program opens up at 9 p.m. We take 21 young people. Anybody who can't get into that program is able to go to one of the other programs, just like at across the city. And so that program's been around 6 years. We also offer two 120-day programs. They're called interim housing programs. One of those programs is dedicated just to pregnant and parenting girls who are ages 14 through 20. Those programs are really designed to help young people set their goals and find more permanent or more stable housing. The Knight Ministry is one of three programs in the city of Chicago that are licensed to provide services, crisis services, to minors. And we are the only program that accepts pregnant and parenting minors and their children. So between those two interim programs, we have 24 beds there. And then our transitional living program is a two-year program for young people. Young people can enter that program up to age 22, and they can stay with us for up to 2 years. And that program is really driven on life skills. So gaining your life skills so that you can move into your own apartment when you're done. All of our longer-term housing programs, young people save while they're with us. So they save a percentage of their income while they're with us, and they can open up a checking account and then use that to put a down payment on an apartment or pay for school if they need to. We have the transitional living program. If you don't have a high school diploma or a GED, you work toward that while you're in the program, because we know that education leads to more opportunity for young people. A unique part of our case management, I think, is that we really work with young people to identify those supportive relationships in their lives so that they know that when they leave our programs, who their supportive relationships are and what's out there for them. What are the healthy relationships in their lives that they can fall back on if they need advice or something like that. We also offer aftercare case management at all of our services. So that means when a young person moves out of our program, they still have access to our staff whenever they need it. I think some of the barriers that we face is there is just not enough transitional housing for young people out there, and not enough affordable housing in general. I think that there's a lack of age-appropriate mental health services for young people. So some of our staff have told me that they think the reason why a lot of young people are homeless is because they have an undiagnosed mental health condition that their families just didn't know how to deal with, and that resulted in their homelessness. And so having age-appropriate mental health services that can really understand what it's like to be a young person dealing with these issues in this city at this time is really critical. And I think some of the outcomes that we face through government funding are sometimes not really geared toward young people. So what I mean by that is, if we place a young person from our transitional living program into a college dorm because they're a full-time college student, that is not considered a successful outcome for us because it's not permanent housing. So even though somebody in their early 20s would be a successful placement, as far as government funders go, that's not considered a successful placement because it's not permanent housing. So that can be a challenge for us at times. So we asked in a recent survey what the young people that we work with needed. And they really said three things. They need transportation to access services. This is a really big city, right? And there's a lot of different providers that work with them all across the city. So for them to access those services without a car, you have to use the bus and the trains. But they don't get discounts for public transit. We don't qualify for reduced fee transit cards as a nonprofit. So that's something that young people really struggle with at times, finding organizations that can provide those linkages to transit. They also say job assistance and job training that leads to jobs where they can make a living wage and actually pay rent for an apartment in a neighborhood where they want to live and feel safe living. And then the last thing is a safe place to stay. So the last thing I want to talk about is we have a new program that we're starting this spring at the Knight Ministry. It's going to be called Phoenix Hall, and it's going to be our first program that's located on the west side of Chicago. It's going to be a really unique program for the city and in the country. It links up we're partnering with North Lawndale College Prep High School, and we're going to be opening a program this spring that would provide transitional housing services for students at North Lawndale College Prep who become homeless. So as a way to provide housing and not disrupt their educational outcomes. So we're really excited about that program. It'll be the first program of its type in Chicago and one of just a few across the country. So, and then I'll talk about budget during the Q&A. Cool.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you for having us. I'm delighted to be here on behalf of Northside Housing and Supportive Services. We are still relatively new to Ravenswood, as we moved here from Lakeview last summer. So we've had a very warm welcome since we've been here. So thank you to many of you for that. Our offices are just across the street from Natalie's over on Ravenswood. We have three primary programs that I'll tell you about. We have three primary programs. Our men's shelter is still in Uptown, and it serves 72 men a night. for up to 4 months who are working on various types of goals. So they receive case management, receive meals, some health care over there. You may have heard about the shelter potentially closing at the end of last year. It was a dramatic and stressful experience for us, but we're delighted that a foundation came through, as well as multiple private funders, individuals and groups, who kept that shelter open and really showed us that there is a commitment in this city to those types of programs, to programs that serve people who are homeless. So it was really exciting to experience that as an organization and to feel that support. So that program still exists over there in Uptown. Because of some increased funding, we've done some remodeling over there. We have a new floor, there's a fresh coat of paint. There's a mural over there that is being installed as we speak. We have an open house this Thursday evening. So I have flyers with more information about that. So if you're interested, come see me afterward and I'll make sure you have that information so you can go check out that space. But that's one of our three programs. Another is the program that I run. It's our Daytime Support Services Center. So this is a center here in Ravenswood where people can drop in during the day. People who are homeless, either in shelter or on the streets, or facing imminent risk of homelessness within the next couple of weeks. The homeless services system is very complicated. Finding out where to go, finding out how to get on certain wait lists, how to find things that you can afford. So the staff over there is geared to navigate that system with the people who come through our doors. So people have a safe space to be, to come during the day. We have food on hand, including ready-to-eat food for people who are hungry, and case managers on call to work with individuals to navigate that system. That of course, people are homeless who are in that program, so they're looking for housing. But we also link people to mental health services, physical health, various employment programs, doing applications there on the spot with people. Whatever that person's goals are, we provide that case management in the moment to them to work toward those goals. And then our other program is similar to one you've heard about already. It's a permanent supportive housing program. So we have units all over the city and case managers based at our office who provide support to people who have moved out of homelessness and into housing. So those we have several veterans programs, so vets who are in subsidized housing now, and case managers work with them to make sure that they're supported. Moving from homelessness to housing is a big deal, especially for people who have been homeless for a long time. We see that in the drop-in center. And so we're there to support that transition and to make sure that's a successful journey and its stability. We try to promote stability as people are moving into housing. There are a few ways, if you're interested, that you can volunteer and get in touch with us to provide support. One of those ways is to cook at the shelter. It's a great opportunity for groups, congregational groups and individuals to go actually see firsthand and meet the guys that are staying over there and provide or help cook a meal in the evenings for the residents at the shelter. There are other opportunities to provide some administrative help. We're always looking for more supplies for both our food pantry as well as our household goods. closet. When people move into housing, we like to give them the things they need. Sheets, towels, dishes. Actually, the 47th Ward has been excellent at collecting those things. I'm sure some of you have dropped donations off, so thank you for that, because they're going to people who have just moved into housing. But perhaps more important than any of that, I want to introduce Carlos to give his story. He is someone who has been a participant in our programs for 6 or 7 years, who has gone from being homeless to being housed. He's a Chicago native from East Chicago, and he celebrates a birthday in just a couple of weeks. So Carlos, tell us a little bit more about yourself.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you very much. I think I rigged this mic just for my height, so. And Natalie, I don't think my cognitive skills are as good as you. This is my life, and I still have to read it off this paper. So. I was born in East Chicago, Indiana, as Jason alluded to. I attended a Catholic grade school and public high school in Hammond, Indiana. Also after that, as colleges, I went to University of South Carolina, UCLA, IUN, Purdue Calumet, with no degrees. My work history, I was a certified tennis teaching professional for 25 years, a civil engineer technician for 25 years, a quality control, quality assurance technician for 7 years. I qualified for Social Security disability on the 20th of December, 2012 to present. My pathways to homelessness. My pathway started as a dysfunctional childhood, with a dysfunctional childhood. My mother left the family when I was 1 year old. Childhood abuse at 10 year old. Note, that was the cause of my PTSD, and I was not diagnosed until 49 years later. Drug and alcohol addiction. Started drinking at 17. Started using crack at 33. Combination of a type 3 childhood trauma, activating event of PTSD, incubated a self-medicating lifestyle culminating with homelessness, penniless, and morally bankrupt. Homelessness to housing first. Housing first is very critical. That is so, so, so important. It helped me get to where I am right now. I started at Chicago Lakeshore Hospital on the 8th of May, 2011. This was my clean date. Pacific Guard Mission, which is a men's shelter and women. Mid-May to mid-June, 2011. Haymarket Treatment Center, June to July, 2011. A Safe Haven Recovery Home, August, September, October, 2011. Featherfist 4-2, a veteran recovery home, November, December, January, 2011 and 2012. Ezra, a Jewish community advocate, referred me in Uptown, referred me to Northside Housing, who introduced me to the Housing First program in coordination with HUD and the VA. Housing First to the present. Ezra, prep me on the paperwork required to qualify. I met my Northside Housing caseworker for my orientation mid-January 2012. After 2 hour orientation, I walked out of the office with three options. I moved into my apartment on the 1st of February 2012. My first year's rent was free. 30% of my rent came from my disability, which started on the 3rd of December, 2012, to present. Okay, the effects of Housing First. This is the cause and effect of what happens when somebody gets stabilized in a safe environment and has no big issues other than improving their lifestyle. And this is what happens. Volunteer Weiss Memorial Hospital Senior Center, 6 years. Community leader, 1 Northside, 6 years. Mentor, sponsor, Jesse Brown VA, Jesse Brown Medical Center VA, 4 years. Board of Directors of Edge Alliance, 3 years. We house and support 125 HIV AIDS clients, tenants. Started training in January this year as coach for peer advocacy with Corporation for Supportive Housing, CSH. Also started January, trained to become a CRSS certified mental health advocate. Natalie, I can't even change these pages. Okay, in summary, I have come a long way since I became clean and sober. And I also sense I've only begun my work. My work consists of maintaining my sobriety, number one and foremost, encouraging my fellow veterans to choose the same path of sobriety. Number two, enlighten myself with seminars, trainings, webinars in the pursuit of understanding my mental health and advocate on others' behalf. I will continue my life of service because I get much more out of it than I put into it. Amen.
Hello, my name is Robert Rodenberg. I'm a person with lived experience of being homeless, being mentally ill, and being in supportive housing. I first joined the predecessors of One North Side as I was being evicted from the Chateau Hotel, one of the series of SROs which were being converted into market rate apartments, which are no longer affordable. And that was the last time I became homeless. But I became an activist while out during the eviction process with Lakeview Action Coalition. You may be more familiar with One North Side's predecessors, Lakeview Action Coalition and the Organization for the Northeast. Now they're known as One North Side, and they cover Ravenswood, North Central, Uptown, Lakeview, Rogers Park, Lincoln Park. So if you live on the northeast side of Chicago, we are your community, main community organization. Affordable housing was a big part of the predecessor organizations and a big part of what Northside does now. Preserving affordable housing, our first campaign that I was involved with was the SRO preservation campaign, and that was one of our biggest successes, and it's been in existence for several years now, and it's successful, and we've saved seven SROs, and the one SRO that did go away didn't go through the regular policy, put money into a fund which helped preserve another SRO. So it's working, and we'll keep monitoring that. But preserving affordable housing is not enough. You need to make sure that affordable housing for market rate renters is available too, and that's part of our new campaign. And you can ask us more about the details later, but it's it has to do with preserving naturally occurring affordable housing. And so we want to avoid gentrification, because when people move out of an area, that makes schools vulnerable. It makes churches vulnerable. It makes small businesses vulnerable. They pay rent too. And if their property taxes or rent go up, guess what? They're gone. So our next campaign has to do with anti-gentrification, which is a problem throughout much of the North Side, as well as other areas like Pilsen and Humboldt Park and Logan Square and other areas. So it's something that everybody needs to worry about, because even if you live in market rate housing, if you start not being able to pay your rent, then you might have to leave the city, which is a big problem, as you probably heard in recent news. Let's see. The people affected about the naturally occurring affordable housing, we are seeking rent, as we see rent soar, low-income people are forced to move out and can't afford to live on the north side, so they have to move elsewhere. And so that destabilizes neighborhoods. I should also say that One North Side is involved with the homeless issue through its recently created, started last year, the Uptown Tent City Voices Heard group. I personally am involved with the, which is basically a tenant organization for the people who live under the viaducts. I'm involved with the homeless organization group called the Uptown Tent City Organizers group, which provides tents and legal advice and other assistance and a hotline as well. I should say that as a homeless person, I've taken advantage of most of these social service agencies here and many of the social service agencies which are listed on the flyer about One North Side. So it is very important that we support these social service agencies in any way we can, including making sure that the Trump budget plan cuts or whatever don't go through. One North Side is involved with street activism. Most recently, the affordable housing team was involved with the Resist Trump Tuesday about the HUD cuts. But we also are willing to talk to aldermen and the mayor's office and that sort of thing. So we should say that One North Side is a social justice organization, so we do have other issue teams fighting for $15 minimum wage and workers' rights and a state budget, which includes, you know, taxing the rich and millionaires pay their fair share and that sort of thing. And so we've been down to Springfield. There's another trip coming up, I think, at the end of the month, and we march in the streets, and we're part of the Moral Monday, so which involves a lot of religious organizations. So if you're not interested in affordable housing, there's other issue teams that would welcome you in. I'm part of both the mental health justice team and the affordable housing team, and we welcome new members. Mary Tirillo here will talk about how we organize buildings and Section 8 buildings, and about how you can get involved. So thank you, Mary.
Thanks, Robert. So another really important form of affordable housing in our communities is Section 8 housing, as Robert said. And here in the 47th Ward, we have Ainslie Manor, which is at Magnolia and Ainslie. It's 50 units that you'd never know was affordable housing, just like much of the affordable housing across the city. You walk by, you have no idea what it is. And so that housing is at risk of being converted to market rate housing, which would displace all of those tenants. And we're organizing the tenants. The alderman here has been very supportive and helpful. And so that's just one example of the kind of housing that we're trying to preserve. Robert did mention our federal work that's amping up again. Trump is proposing a $6.6 billion cut to HUD, which is a 13% cut overall of the HUD budget, which would completely eliminate community development block grants. I think Ted is going to talk about this a little more later, but this would be devastating to our communities, devastating to us trying to solve the homelessness problem. This would be definitely a step in the wrong direction. And so we had, as Robert said, a Resist Trump Tuesday that was focused on housing. And our goal is to really get the HUD cuts out in the news, and then also to connect Trump to the Heritage Foundation. The Heritage Foundation has this agenda that Trump is following to a T, and we want to expose. Trump is not the working man's billionaire. Trump is making cuts to the HUD budget and to the budget overall to help his friends. So this isn't, you know, we got a story in the Tribune. It's a good start. We need to be connecting the dots over the next 4 years so that in 4 years we're not fighting the same fight. We need a new president in 4 years. We need a new, anyway, this is a little off. We're a 501c3 organization. But at the same time, it's our job to be exposing the atrocities that Trump is, you just can't not talk about it. So that's another thing that we're trying to tackle. And as far as getting involved, this is really hard stuff. We need people to come to the table to help us strategize, to help us figure out how do we make sure that in 4 years we're not fighting these same fights. We need to figure out what campaigns do we need to wage in order to really guarantee housing for all and the human right to housing for everybody in our communities. We need help organizing events. We need help. We need meeting people to meet with local aldermen to say, I support this as a resident of the 47th Ward. I support affordable housing. That's really important to have people in support of that. We need people to do outreach to their neighbors, to get them involved, to attend actions, to plan actions. Our affordable housing team meets every other month, but then we have these different campaigns that meet more regularly. We'd love to have you join us at those meetings. There's a lot of opportunities to get involved, and we'd love to talk with you more afterwards about specifics that we mentioned here and how you could do that. Thanks.
Tell them about bingo night.
We got bingo night next week. We'll let you let them.
Bingo can solve a lot of problems, I've heard. That's great. So first of all, I just want to say a big thank you to our panelists for finding ways to... I guess it's obviously some people here who have found ways to merge their professional skills with their personal passion. And we're thankful for that. We're thankful for the stories that the two gentlemen shared about their journey. And if we just think of one of these stories and multiply that by hundreds of thousands, number one, you'll get a sense of how big the problem is. And it might scare us to think that the problem is too overwhelming that we could actually do anything. So I think that's one thing that we want to make sure that we don't get scared that the problem is too big. And so I wanted to, because I think what we heard tonight was we heard you guys talk about various stages of homelessness, various types of homelessness, various solutions in terms of the housing options. And so I wanted to maybe just kick off the questions, and then we want to hear from you guys. But I look at this and I say, you know, when you mentioned something like $6.6 billion being cut from HUD, it just makes it sound like, you know, we're all in a mess, and you know, more people are going to have more of these stories that will be tragic. But I also think that when people here in this room, if we bring that down to just the one single story level and the personal level, and most of us, when we encounter seeing a person that's homeless in our neighborhood, you know, I want to hear from some people in terms of what that feels like, what we've done, what can we do. You know, when you see one person that maybe either in maybe have some safety concerns, some health concerns, maybe trouble on the street, one person that you may want to try to find to help, what is the best way that someone should do? We've heard people should just call 311. We've heard don't give money. The Pope says go ahead and give money, so we're okay either way with that. We've heard referral to certain programs that you guys have. So can one of you just pick that issue itself and just say, as we're walking in our neighborhood, we see someone and it compels us to try to do something, what is that something that we could do in that moment? And you can either yell it out or borrow the mic here.
Well, I just talked to a bunch of kids about this a couple weeks ago at an elementary school. I think you all know this, but the number one thing is to acknowledge it's a human being who's like having a life experience, and that homelessness is not all that person is. So look at the person, smile at them, say hello. Personally, I think you can give money or not. I don't think there's a right or wrong answer that way. And then I think you can let them know you heard about these programs. We have information, I have information, I'm sure they do too, to give you information about our programs. If you have that in your pocket to give to somebody, maybe they know, but maybe they don't. And maybe someone decides to give my center a call or drop into their office and gets the information that helps them in that moment. But I think fundamentally, it's about acknowledging a human connection.
Being a product of the streets myself, enduring those red line stops from the 95th to Howard Street just to get some rest and some respite. I go on a red line now to do a lot of my social work. And what I do, always carry an extra several bananas or sandwiches with me. When someone confronts me with a, can you help me out with the money and so on, and even the blind people coming on to you with their canes and stuff, that story doesn't resonate with me one bit. What resonates with me is whether they will accept the food that I have just for those circumstances. On a one-on-one basis, we can all do this while we carry on our daily lives. Give some food to somebody. Acknowledge that person, as Jason alluded to. Acknowledge that person. One of the worst things you can do in being homeless is to be ignored. That is the absolute worst, to be ignored. If you can just show a kind smile, it doesn't cost anything. And if you feel frisky enough, give that person a hug.
Yeah, we're gonna a few more minutes and we'll go there. So I hear there, it's, you know, make your personal decisions, but start with kindness, compassion, caring, and understanding, and we can all make the world a better place with starting with that one individual. So now let's go to the big issue of the $6.6 billion, and we know that that's probably only going in one direction. I know a lot of the organizations rely on federal funding, state funding, city funding, but we heard some stories of others, like the shelter that was getting shut down, and it, you know, had to come to that crisis moment, but there were foundations and individuals that helped to save that. So Ted, maybe you can talk a little bit about the federal budget and quickly just address what that means, and then are there substitutes for that that we might also be able to help you guys with?
So the budget discussion period is really early, right? We got a couple weeks ago the blueprint budget, which is also called the skinny budget. So it doesn't give you a lot of details, but it gives you an idea of where the president's thinking. And so as One Northside said, there's huge cuts to various departments. I think all but three federal agencies really receive cuts in the new budget. It's a $6 billion cut for HUD. The cut at HHS is about 18%. Health and Human Services receives an 18% cut in the budget. Under the HUD budget, community development block grants would be eliminated. Under the HHS budget, community services block grants would be eliminated. And that's concerning because those two funding pools usually trickle down to the city level. So Chicago receives community development block grant money that then they give to local organizations. They receive community services block grant money that they give to local organizations. And so if those funds are cut at the federal level, the city has less money to work with as well. We don't know a lot about the other funding lines. So the big funding line at HUD is called the Homeless Assistance Grants. And that funding line has, we don't know what the impact on that would be under this budget. We have to wait for the full budget to come out to learn about that. Another program at HHS that's under threat of being eliminated is LIHEAP. It's the Low Income Heating Assistance. Yeah, and so that provides utility assistance, which sometimes can help people stay in their homes. Because so many people make that decision every day. Am I going to pay my utilities? Am I going to pay my rent? Can I afford food? Do I have enough money to go to the doctor? And so if they can receive that LIHEAP money, it takes one of the concerns off their plate, right? So that's also slated to be cut. We do know at HHS that there is going to be an increase in money for opioid addiction treatment, which is something that we're starting to see in some of our outreach sites around the city, so heroin addiction and things like that. There will be more treatment money for that, which I think is really needed. One of my biggest concerns, though, is that the budget is going to cut the entire budget for the U.S. Interagency Council on Homelessness. It's called USICH. And that's been around since the late 80s. And I think it's really done some great work in probably the last 5 to 10 years. So under the Obama administration, they released a new plan to end homelessness in the United States. It's called Opening Doors. And so a lot of the money that has been really effective working with veterans came out of that plan. And USICH is the organization that kind of guides that plan and makes sure that all the federal agencies are working on that plan. Right now, they're doing a lot of work around chronic homelessness, so people who experience multiple incidences of homelessness, and youth homelessness and families are the next groups to be covered by that plan. So if USICH goes away, a lot of the coordination between the federal agencies may go away. A lot of the best practices and the dissemination of those best practices to the field might go away as well. So that's particularly concerning as we think about what's like the next 5 to 10 years of ending youth homelessness in the city. That's concerning for us because that agency would be gone. So that's kind of what we see. And just the impact that budget might have on the local level, seeing that our state has fiscal problems. We know our city, the spending at our city level is not going up at all. So federal cuts could be really disastrous to a lot of organizations who rely heavily on government funds, because there isn't going to be government funds to replace them at the state or city level, it looks like. So that's really concerning. And I do think that, like we said, foundations are a source of funding for us. And that's really where innovation drives. So while it would be great to say that foundations can make up that gap that government isn't able to pay, then we lose the power that some of that money has to provide us with new ways to serve this population. Because if that money has to go to cover existing services, how do we fund the new things that we want to start? So it's really concerning on a number of levels.
Yes.
I'm Dick Simpson, former alderman. I'm on the board of Northside Housing and Social Services. I wanted to make just 2 points related to your last question. First of all, in my view, this is a crisis year. So if you ever plan to do anything about homelessness, better do it this year. I'll explain why in just a second. I already had part of the explanation. The state is paying $0, $0 cents. They do not have a budget. We nearly had to close the shelter on Lawrence Avenue last July, and then the state had an emergency budget that gave us money. To run the shelter on Lawrence cost us $500,000 a year. When the state was paying through the city, we got $400,000 a year. So we only had to make up $100,000 to run the shelter for 72 people. It would have been literally a life and death issue if we'd finished having to close the shelter. 72 people would have been out on the street freezing to death in Chicago in winter, even though this was a relatively mild winter. And that's a nightmare. We serve a lot of other people, a lot of them the way we care about. So there are two parts. One, there has to be political opposition to the state paying nothing. the federal government talking about massive cuts that will double or triple the homeless population and make it impossible to get most people off of homelessness. And we need, and as we've got a little bit of a grace period because we already have the contracts from the federal government for the next year. We've got a year to build up the number of churches that back these organizations. We've got a year for individuals to decide they're going to be helpful and either volunteering or money. We've got a year to find some foundations, and that's beyond the, I'm all for the political resistance. I'll join you at the barricades for both the state and the federal government. They're both disasters for all sorts of reasons, this being only one. But we, so in addition to the political resistance, trying to force the state to have a budget, trying to force the congressmen to not give the cuts that are being proposed, we need to make the agencies as resilient as possible. We've got 1 year in which to do that work. If we don't strengthen the agencies with the support of the community, they're going to have a very hard time withstanding the pressures that are going to come from the government cuts.
Okay, thank you very much. That's a call to action there. And just one final comment that I wanted to make before we break out and you get a chance to ask some more directed questions. I just wanted you to look around the room for a second and just don't underestimate what you're doing here right now just by being here. Most of these community meetings are people that are against this stuff. It's a tent city, they want to get removed. It's the SRO that they want to get renovated and turned into market rate housing. It's affordable housing that's a part of the city's. The city has an ordinance to encourage affordable housing, yet it still goes to community meetings where everyone comes out against it. And if you pack the room, those are the voices that they hear. So even just a couple of your voices at these community meetings to tell a story, to share your view, to share with them what you've learned here tonight, that you're an advocate for these people on the streets, advocate for people who've lived some tough lives, if haven't had the support or the breaks that we've had, be their voice, and I think you can help. Yes?
I'll stay right here.
Oh, there you go.
So, I don't think anyone in this room is complacent. But it is incumbent on every one of us to get those potential complacents who, i.e., are advocating for these new rules and regulations. Get your family, your sphere of influence, your family member, your friends, get them off the rail. Get them in the game. Get them involved, because we need everyone more and more. That is what's going to work. We are under fire. Even the sanctuary part is being divested as we speak today, I heard. So let's get involved. Stay in the game. Get your family members involved, because I understand you're not complacent, but let's eliminate that complacency in our lives too. Because complacency equals advocate. We don't want people to advocate for the existing conditions. We want to improve on that.
So we're going to have each one of these groups at a separate table. So if you have questions of them, you can get them answered. Because one of the most important things is your takeaway. I know for personally, what can I do? What can I do? That's always, you know, my question. So if you have that question and you want to know what you can do, they're going to be in three separate tables so you can find out how to get involved, whether it's with your Girl Scout troop or your church or just you as an individual, because they've got the answers for what they need. Thank you very much. Thank you.